This is the Pebble Hicks Law test. It's a test of simple response or choice response time, and it varies the number of options. This is just a demonstration version I have set up, so just 10 trials per condition. So it varies the number of options, and it looks at how response time changes, increases usually, as a function of the number of options. So I'll just go through these three conditions really quickly and then show you a little bit more about the test. So here we have a set of two, four, and six options. And you can see which options were, how many responses, what my accuracy was, and overall response time. Mean and median, which is the second and the last and the second to last column. You can see here that for whatever reason, because I had relatively few trials, there's really no systematic or maybe normal regular difference between response time as the number of options increases. However, the Hicks law is a description of how this response time changes as the number of options change. Now, Hicks' law is frequently misinterpreted. It's used in usability studies frequently to to rationalize removing options, removing buttons, and it's kind of exactly the opposite of what Hicks' law says. So Hicks' law says that the time it takes you to make a decision will increase as a log of the number of options. So it sort of means that every additional option costs you less than the previous option in terms of time. And so it actually is, it may be it may be con I guess contrary to its popular use, ways of justifying adding more options or adding more buttons because it doesn't cost you that much once you have a certain number. Of course, Hicks' law is a version, well, Hicks' law was I think first described in the 50s. And then shortly thereafter, Ray Hyman redescribed it in terms of information, which is even more useful for usability because it says it's not just the number of options, it's the information on the options. So essentially, you can have a lot of very low probability options, and they don't affect your mean response time very much at all. Which, again, for usability, is exactly how the opposite of how Hicks' law is sometimes cited. So if you have a bunch of things that are never used very often, the Hick-Hyman law should say it won't matter much in response time. But of course, people like to have fewer options and things like that. And furthermore, you know, the law is established when you have a single, you're not looking between things, you have a single response to make, a single easy stimulus to make, and once you have other things like mouse movements, then other laws come into effect, like Fitts' law. So it becomes more complicated. So anyway, this is our basic Hicks' law test, and just a couple things. This started as a classroom exercise, and I've used this in a number of different classes, and in fact, the materials I use are available. If you install Pebble and you go to Pebble 2.0 demo classroom, there's a number of simple tasks with sometimes with materials I've used in the classroom, and I've got one for Hicks' law and sort of a lab exercise that goes through having students collect data on themselves and compare it to. So that's targeted towards this one. Now I've changed this into a more battery-like test, which is available within battery under Hicks. Right, let's see, right here. Okay, so first, there's a couple things in this design that you should think about. So I wanted to be able to give as few or as many options as possible, and you really can't easily permit 10 different responses, because you only have really 8 fingers that you can easily make responses with. Your thumbs, are kind of awkward. So, especially when the response for this is the number line on the top of the keyboard. So I decided to make the responses the number line on the top of the keyboard, which means you can put your fingers up on the top of the keyboard and easily make 8 responses. And when it goes to 10, you have to sort of have your index finger do double duty. It turns out that that's not too much trouble, but it's something to keep in mind. Now, by default, we can look at the default parameters. Actually, the one I just did had the highlight color gold rather than red, which is the default. And usually there's 50 blocks per trial, but I just had 10, so I wouldn't have to go through 50, 150, 200 blocks while I was talking to you. You can, between each trial, especially when you have just one or two options, if there's only one option, then you could become really fast by knowing exactly when it's coming. So there's a ITI variability here. By default, it's not very variable, but you could increase this if you want it synced to a longer trial interval and make it more variable. So right now, between each stimulus, it's between 300 and 500 milliseconds. You can fix the key labels. This might be interesting because you could go even do things like RRRRRLLLLL, which is, stimulus response incompatibility, or you could try other labels. You could have them unlabeled like this so that people have to memorize it. I've tried this. We'll look at what that looks like. You can see if they get actual feedback on each response, if they do it incorrectly. And now it will use how many ever rounds you want to use up to 8. So by default, it uses 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 rounds. And you can see it starts with 1, then 2, then 3, then 4, then 5, then. No, then 6, then 8. And that, 8 rounds of 50 trials each is 400 trials at about a second or 2 seconds each. That ends up being 7 or 8 minutes, probably. Between 7 and 10 minutes, depending on how fast your participants are and what your ITI is. So, all you need to do to add a round is put the responses you want to put in into that round, or leave it blank and it won't use the round. So it's smart enough to know that. You can also, try things like, well, what if I do 1 and 5 and 6 and 0? You could try a lot of different things about changing the responses to see if when numbers are close together, is it slower? Things like that. So this could be used with different parameter settings to explore a lot of things about manual responses that probably have never been studied in great detail, or maybe were studied back in the 60s, but aren't currently studied a lot. Or maybe they are, and there's stuff that there's certainly people who've studied details of motor programming. So I don't want to. I don't know a lot about it, though. So this is measuring the basic Hick's law phenomena. I described the Hick-Hyman law. This won't help you with the Hick-Hyman law. Now, the Hick-Hyman law, you would want to put different probabilities on these. So what if you had 4, 5, 6, and 7, but 5 and 6 happened 80% of the time, and 4 and 7 happened 20% of the time? So that's not possible in this. It could be possible with editing, but it then gets really complicated with another set of parameters to add for each of these. So this is just the Hick law phenomena. Okay. So I edited the parameters, and now you can see I could go back to the default, or I could use this setting. Actually, let's change this to dark green to see what happens when we change the color. We'll do, since I have four, maybe 20 trials will give us slightly better, more reliable responses. And let's see if there's any other settings to consider. Okay, there's very simple instructions here. So it asks you to put your fingers on the keyboard above. Here, actually, this dark green makes it a little more difficult because it's harder to distinguish from the gray, probably depending on the lighting conditions and your screen as well. So if you're interested in making it more difficult, you could make the highlight color like a slightly darker gray. So there's very little change between the two. That might be an interesting manipulation to see if that just adds a linear effect or a non-linear effect to the responses as the number of responses increase. I think it's good to incorporate the feedback, the correct and incorrect feedback, because it is really easy to get your fingers on the wrong buttons. And if you didn't have that correct feedback, someone could go through a whole block and not recognize their fingers are on the wrong buttons. So that's a useful thing to have. So here we're at with six. And this, you can see that this is getting a little slower, a little more difficult to distinguish. I don't really see a significant advantage to having the numbers there. It's actually pretty well lined up with my fingers on the screen anyway. So here we can see the mean response time went from 429 to 484 to 524. And that probably is well described by Hick's law. You can see that the increase from 2 to 4 was about 50 milliseconds. And you'd expect if it's a log relationship that 4 to 8 would be another 50. And we see that 4 to 6 is about 40 milliseconds, a little less than 50. So, along with noise and stuff, maybe, and differing error rates, it's probably reasonably well described by Hick's law. So when you finish, your data will appear. That was subject participant code 132. Your data will appear within Pebble Battery Hick's data, and here is the first round. Here's an older round, and here's the most recent one I did. Two files will be saved. One has a trial by trial record of every response, and so you can see here there's 60 trials plus the header 61. I can see, let's see, I'm not sure what that 20 is supposed to indicate. That's probably the number of trials. This is the interstimulus delay that happened to be chosen that time, so it's going to differ every time. This is what the stimulus was. This is what my response was. This was what the correct response was, which is should be, identical to this. And this is whether I was correct, and here's my response time. And so it's pretty simple, and you can see as we move toward additional trials. Actually, one thing that this is not recording is the trials or the options. I will have to edit this to make analysis easier so that you can know what the different options are. But we had 20 with 2, 20 with 4, and 20 with 6. And you could use that to find exactly the same things that this report file will produce. So the report file will aggregate by number of options, what the options were, how many responses in each, accuracy, mean time, and median time. Also a timestamp and how long it took. So it took 1.7 minutes for 20. So it's probably pretty that's probably pretty linear. So if you increase it to 50, it might take I don't know, about 4 minutes for that. If you increase it to more options, it might scale up to 5 to 10 minutes, depending on how many options you use. All right, so that's the data, and we showed how to change different settings. There's a few things you could translate here. There is nothing you can translate here, I guess. Let's see. There are a few, here we go. There are a few things you can translate: the initial instructions and debriefing. If you're using this in a test of a bunch of other with a bunch of other tests, you might want to change this. Instead of the test complete, say press OK to continue to the next test, or alert the experiment that sure that you're done. And so it's pretty, there's not much to translate. The only thing to think about here is this label is going to tell you which keys you're going to respond to now. So you have to include this uppercase, less than label, greater than, and then it will do some automatic search and replace to replace that. All right. Well, that is the Pebble Hicks law. Oh, let's see what it looks like if we were to change this to a different gray. I mean, gray 55. This is sort of a middle gray. So that's probably easier to see. What if I were to change it to gray 35, I think. Yeah, so this might be a way of inducing a difficulty by making the shade of gray very similar to the background shade. Again, it doesn't, here it doesn't make seem to make much of a difference to me, but maybe when you have a bunch of options, it could increase response time by 10 or 20 milliseconds on average. All right, well, that is the Pebble Hicks law test. And you can use it to assess in a classroom how choices increase, the response time for choices increases, the number of options increase. You can also use it as an individual measure of speed. And then not only do you have average speed, but you also have how speed is impacted by the complexity of it. So sometimes you find, for different manipulations, choice differences in response time based on for complex choice tasks, but not for simple choice tasks. So this could be a way of incorporating both of those in one as a function of some other, either individual difference or manipulation you do for dual tasking or something. All right, well, thank you.